so close, it's right in your mouth, praise God. If. That's the only variable is what you got to say, praise God. Amen. So, all right, there'll be no others. I think the baby's from 0 to 3 already in the nursery. Amen. And we're going to just go ahead and share the word. Praise God. I don't think I'll be here very, very long. But take a mental note of those that are absent today. My head is just full of people right now. I can just name off that I don't see. Some for vacation out of town, but some are not out for legitimate reasons. They're just getting weak. And you have to be from a position that I stand and look over, I look out to the congregation. You just wouldn't pick that up. But somebody is growing. It's really, really weak. Hallelujah. So give somebody a call. Amen. Look around and see if you see our ring. See if you see it. See if you see Kristen. Sister Judy, is she here? All right. Praise God. Amen. See if they come during the week. Amen. Bible study. They're in the Word. They're getting strength. Are they forsaken the assembly? Hallelujah. And then the Bible says, and I might have said this last week, he that observes lying vanities does what? Forsake his own mercy. Praise God. Circumstances, situations, look at them. Focus on those. Pay attention to that. The newspaper said, the radio said, the newsman said, the economy said, the presidential candidate said, and then you forsake your own mercy. Praise God. When deliverance is nigh, it's nigh thee. That is the word of faith that we preach. Hallelujah. All righty, praise God. Let's see if we can put a title on today's word, on today's ministry of the gospel, the preaching of the gospel. I thank God who has called me to minister the gospel, to be set for the defense of the gospel. Hallelujah. And like Paul says, was this grace given? Because I didn't come out of school looking to preach. I came out of school looking to be something else. When I determined that I couldn't make it in sports, just too small, I said, well, I'm making it in the job market, in the regular old secular world, businessman and so forth. But still, one day he decided that, Williams, you ought to get saved. You're going to get saved. And I'll tell folks, I'm not getting saved. See, look at the party I'm giving. Look at the fun I'm having. It's not okay. But as I drove back and forth from the party to my residence, and I was doing pretty good back in those days, I had a 1971 Monte Carlo, burnt orange, black top, white seats. It was looking good, Sister Dorothy. I was looking good. Probably had some kind of cap on, tilted. Seemed like there's somebody in my back seat saying, now, what are you going to do when you die? And I would literally turn around and say, how can I have had so much fun and that kind of question come up? Praise God. But it kept bugging me. That kind of question kept on. And finally, circumstances worked out where, how many of Mother Tucker, you might be familiar with the ministry, her son, Dole, he and I were working downtown. We always, different companies, always seemed to head for lunch at the same time and cross paths. And then he said to me, one day he says, are you about ready to get saved? It caught me off guard. And I said, yeah. I said, you know what? As a matter of fact, I think I'm going to go do that this evening. So that was on a Tuesday. And that Tuesday I came here, Fellowship Hall, and confessed Christ. Pastor Hill was the minister. He ministered salvation to me. And that's how I got saved. You know, that's the Holy Ghost working with me. One planet, somebody wanted, and just kept working. And then I came to accept Jesus as my Lord and Savior. And that day, it seemed like the weight of the world was lifted off my shoulder. Glory to God. That's what the new birth would do for me, praise God. And ever since that day, the Word has always been a love of mine, praise God. I just love the Word, praise God. It's just, before then, it was like Greek. But when I went home that night and read Matthew and read some of Genesis, it was crystal clear. Hallelujah. And it got clearer and clearer as time goes on. Now, here's what I want to say to us today. those that are believers. Any believers in here? All right, let's put the subject. Cast not away your confidence. Don't throw your confidence away. And that is in the scripture. We'll find that verse in a little bit. But cast not away your confidence. In the book of James, the first chapter, let's look there right quick. James, the first chapter, and verse 2. My brethren, count it all joy when you fall into what? Diverse temptations. Count it all joy, knowing this, that the trying of your faith does what? Worketh patience. So sometimes we are in the situation we might find ourselves in, some adversity, things are upside down, the yoke didn't sit the fan in life, things are just not going right. Here's what he says, count it all joy when you fall into diverse temptations. And that could be anything from sickness to a disease, poverty, lost job, loss, whatever the devil is maybe throwing your way, count it all joy when you, and the key word here is fall. When you fall, because no one walks into sickness on purpose, amen. No one walks into poverty on purpose, amen. But sometimes you might, how many walk on the kitchen floor and slip? Sidewalk full of one way or the other, and you just, oh, I'm flat on my face. How did I get here? You fall, you fail, you got tripped up. You wasn't paying attention to something. You didn't notice. You wasn't aware. And now you're in a mess. Anybody can identify with what Brother William just talked about? I'll fall, I'll fail. I definitely don't want to be here, but here I am. How do you get here? You fail. You wasn't paying attention. Now, I tell folks all the time, you don't have to be in that adversity, because God wants us to have all good things to what? Enjoy. All, you name it. He wants good life. St. John 10:10, I've come that you might have life and have it in abundance. Even though you are a good, strong believer, what you find is that I'm in some type of a mess. Some type of a negative, adverse situation. What am I going to do about it? Well, here, James says, count it all joy. Count it all joy. In other words, you can get out of it. Glory to God. Things will change. Glory to God. You don't have to stay the way you are. All right, let's look at this here. So it's various kinds of trials. And we can name them. Various kinds of trials. But how do I get out of this? If you look at verse 8, you'll see here a key. It says, a double-minded man is unstable in all his ways. So you have to get on one track. And you got to determine your track. Whether it's going to be a track full of confidence in what God's word says, or you're going to be wishy-washy back and forth. So a double-minded man, don't be double-minded, because if you're double-minded, you won't get anything. Nothing good will happen for you. So you have to set your course. You have to set your sail. And you have to, just like you're out on a boat on the water, you have to raise that sail up and set it in the right direction, and that's where we're going. Set your sail. David, the psalmist, says that though he slay me, yet will I trust him. He says, though there be no food in the cupboards, the mountain fall into the sea, yet I'm still going to be standing in faith. So here's this faith preaching, this faith that we preach, and it is something that you have to hold on to no matter what comes up. Because when you fall, it's only because you slipped up. You did not pay attention to something. The devil found an opening. He took a shot. He had a chance. And that's what, so you fall. How many have ever done something like that? Fall into. So I'm into a mess. Now what? He says, well, count it all joy. Because your setback is a setup for God to show himself strong on your behalf. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Everybody don't have to slip, but sometimes somebody slips. And you say, now what? I got a setback. No, not really. It's an opportunity for God to show himself strong on your behalf. But you gotta work with God. You gotta work with him. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Glory to God. Well, let's see what we have here. Why can I take that position? How can I be assured that I can take that position? And the Lord kind of led me over to the book of Hebrews. Hebrews, the 7th chapter. Glory. And he had me kind of compare some realities here. He says, 7th chapter, verse 1, this guy Melchizedek, king of Salem, priest of the Most High God, met Abraham returning from the slaughter of the kings and blessed him. And we're pretty sure you know the story of Abraham coming back after he rescued Lot and had his fall. And this is the first instance in the Bible that we see of Abraham paying tithe to a priest. But I want to tell you that this is just not a priest. This was a high priest. And Abraham paid tithe to him, as the story goes. And it says in verse 3 of chapter 7, this high priest, he was without father, without mother. He had no beginning of days, nor end of life, but he was made like unto the Son of God. He abided a priest continually. Now consider how great this man was, unto whom even the patriarch Abraham gave a tenth, or gave a tithe of all of what he had accomplished or conquered through war. Now, I want you to look at the key verses and look at verse 21 again. For those priests, I'm going to say that this time, I'm jumping a little bit ahead of myself, but those priests were made without an oath, but this was an oath by him that said unto him, the Lord swear and would not repent, thou a priest forever after the order of Melchizedek. Yeah. Now, it seems like we're trying to figure out who is this Melchizedek, and it says after the order, after things that were set up for him to minister, and what did he do? You got to be in the steps, and you got to be in the continuation like Melchizedek. Many folks don't have any idea. Melchizedek. So what was so unique about him? Well, the Bible says there is no beginning of days recorded. We don't even know who his father is. It's not recorded in time who his mother is. But he met Abraham, and Abraham paid tithe to Melchizedek. Okay, so we go on and we say that we saw how, let's see here. Go into verse 15 of chapter 7. It is yet for more evidence, for that after the similitude of Melchizedek, there arise another priest, who is made not after the law of a carnal commandment, but after the power of an endless life. For he testified, thou art a priest forever after the order of Melchizedek. And this is what the Lord is saying about your priest, your high priest. You've fallen into a negative situation. And I want to know, what is the ministry of Jesus Christ right now? What's he doing? Somewhere in your Bible, it says that he is seated as a high priest. in heaven, seated as a high priest in heaven. And his job there is to make intercessions for you and I. So if you fall into a situation, some negativity, some adversity, what you want to know is that who's on my side? Who's helping me out? Where does my help come from? And my high priest, the one making intercessions for me, is he really qualified? Is he capable of getting the ear? And not only that, but is he capable of getting into the presence of God for me? Now, back in the day of we'll say Melchizedek, sometimes we get Melchizedek mixed up with the order of Moses. And it's a vast difference between the priest Aaron and Levitical priesthood. That's a vast, it's a difference, uniqueness between Moses, Aaron, and Joshua, and all those people that ministered in the tabernacle in the wilderness versus this priest, this high priest called Melchizedek. Well, what is the difference? Moses established the priesthood, the tabernacle in the wilderness that they had to travel with. And it had in it the it had this tent, and it had you enter in the table of showbread, candlestick, all these kind of sacrifices were made, and by the priest. And then there was a second veil, if you remember, and that second veil is called the Holy of Holies. And when you enter into that, past that second veil, you were actually in the presence of God. And that's where those priests, high priests, would make intercessions and pray for the people. Amen. And they would do that continually all the time. But this Melchizedek, and say this, Moses gave the order to build this tabernacle and put the covenant, have it overlaid with the cherubims. That was by the law. Do it according to the law. But Melchizedek, his work as a high priest was that it was based on promises. And I want you to understand in your Bible that it never tells us that Jesus is our high priest after the Levitical priesthood, after Moses' structure. Never says nothing like that in your Bible. It says Jesus is a high priest like Melchizedek. I'd like to figure out what Melchizedek was all about. Well, Melchizedek, his priesthood was based on a covenant of promises. Absolute, solid promises from God. Melchizedek, you are the high priest. And you minister in the sanctuary as well, but yours is not basically when Aaron and them entered into the sanctuary, they had to go to the table of showbread, the lampstick. And if you know what all those things were all about, sacrificing and praying for the sins of the people. I had to acknowledge, oh man, well, I slipped. Some people ascribe this. I fell into temptation. I fell into a mess. Adversity, because I sinned somewhere. I went against God somewhere. And that's why I'm in this mess. And that's why the priest in Moses' order had to go in and offer up prayers and sacrifices and pray for the people before they could even make intercession for them. But this Melchizedek, he didn't have that kind of order. There was no thing as a lampstand, showbread, make a sacrifice. This Melchizedek had access to the holies of holies based on promises. Whoa. And it says to you about your high priest that Jesus is a high priest after the order of Melchizedek. the same ordinance, the same everything that Melchizedek operated by. That's what Jesus is operating by. Let me show you here in the Word. Glory, hallelujah. Hebrews 7. Verse 21. For these priests were made without an oath, but this with an oath by him that said unto him, the Lord swear, and I would not repent. Thou art a priest forever after the order of Melchizedek. By so much was Jesus made a surety for a better testament. And they truly were many priests, because they were not suffered to continue by reason of death. But this man, because he continued ever, has an unchangeable priesthood. He's able also to save them to the uttermost that come unto God by him, seeing he ever liveth to make intercessions for them. That's what Jesus is doing. He's at God's right hand, and all his life is about, his total existence is about praying, making intercessions for you. For such a high priest became us, who was holy, harmless, undefiled, separated from sinners, made higher than the heavens, who need not daily, as those high priests, offer up sacrifices for his own sins and then for the people's. For this he did, how many times did Jesus die? Once, when he offered up himself. So when you boldly proclaim that I am well, I am blessed, you don't have to go through some sanctuary looking for forgiveness of sins or making some kind of sacrifices, even blood sacrifices. You don't have to do that. Especially in your mind. When your mind says, I must have sinned, I must have let God down somewhere, your mind is saying you have a conscience of sin instead of a conscience of promises from the throne of God. And this is what God promises. He promises good things to enjoy. But the devil will throw you up a smoke screen, and you think that I have to, he'll make you think that, and it's called a consciousness of sin. And when there's a consciousness of sin, God can't work. Oh, Lord. I wonder if it's hot in here. I'm beginning to sweat. Glory, hallelujah. Look at chapter 8. He says this. Now, I want to paint you a picture. Jesus' ministry is a ministry. His job is what I want to call, stuff I don't want to ever say, he's a manager of heaven. He's a manager of heaven. And what he does is that he makes sure that things in heaven can get to the people that's believing in heaven. All health, wealth, blessings, peace of mind, all this stuff, he's the minister of that sanctuary, and his job is to get it down to the people on the earth who believe in him. He's a God's right. He's a minister of the sanctuary. Now, here's the difference. I'm going to show you. The tabernacle in the wilderness, when they traveled through, it was a tabernacle made by man. It was ordered of God, but it was made by man. And the only strength that that tabernacle had was as long as God's presence was in that tabernacle. And as long as there was a priest, according to ordinances, doing what he was supposed to do. But here we have a sanctuary in heaven, paid for by one with his own blood. Yes. And when he died and went up into heaven to show that his blood was pure and worthy, that's why the Bible says, how much more should the blood of Jesus versus the blood of bull and goats satisfy, change your mind from dead works to serve and believe in the living God? See, if you're thoroughly convinced that Jesus' blood was presented to God's throne room at the mercy seat for me, then I don't have to deal, I don't have to accept, I don't have to. But if I do fall into some work of the devil, God's mercy is there for me. Hallelujah. Now here's what most people do. They get into negative situations, they cast away their confidence. And the Bible says don't do that, because your confidence has a great recompense or reward. Hallelujah. If you believe to the same, I mean, he's coming to pull you out. You're not going to be sick forever. That's the devil's bill of sale. He's trying to say, you're not going to be poor forever. You're not going to live with paycheck to paycheck from now on. Walking around with holes in your shoes. That's the bill of goods the devil is trying to sell you. But if you can say that, I have an intercessor higher than the heavens, made after a promise, a testament, a promise that was given to me. That's how he works in that sanctuary, by the promises. Father, you promised health. God said, yes, I did. Health. Are they in believing? Are they in faith? Are they believing? Yes, they're in faith. They're believing. Health is yours. Oh, hallelujah. Oh, hallelujah. I can't even look at my notes. I'm getting so excited here. So the earthly tent operation is, the earthly tent operation was just a shadow of things to come. It was just a shadow. It was just a, this is how it's going to be in heaven. See this tent? Yeah. See this sacrifice? You go in here and make this first entry. You do a sacrifice offering, a washing of hands, lampstick, showbread. That was on the earth. See this big veil of a wall? Yeah, you're not allowed to go in there on the other side. Who can do that? The high priest. He's got to take some blood in there. Okay, so we got to kill something. Now Jesus himself, that's the earthly. But Jesus himself took his own blood on the other side of that veil and offered it up. And he says, I'm doing this for one time. And so pointing it to man wants to die. As a man, I'm doing this one time. Here's my blood. Pour it on the mercy seat for the sins of the people. Glory to God. And what? So and he says, now I'm after the order of Melchizedek, not based on the law on the other side of that veil, but right here. How much more valuable is my blood? Oh boy. I thought I had to stop y'all from dancing after that. That's all I know is that he offered it up once. And you don't have to do it again because he's not dying again. He made one sacrifice for the weakness of the people, and that's it. He says, now all they got to do is believe what I did. And they can walk around, and if they fall, they can rejoice because they know he's going to pull them back up. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Ooh, hallelujah. That's what we talked about in Bible study Wednesday night when Peter walked on the water. But Peter had a little doubt. He failed. I don't want to get into that. Second bell, holy as well. Okay, now. Hallelujah. Hebrews 9 and 9. We're going to be getting out here in a little bit. So, no, we're talking about that first, look at Hebrews 9 and 1. Then verily the first covenant had also ordinances of divine service and a worldly sanctuary. There was a tabernacle made, the first candlestick, table, showbread, which is called the sanctuary. That's what I've been describing. And after the second veil, the tabernacle, which is called the holiest of all. And that it describes the things that was in there. Verse 4, verse 5 shows about the cherubim. Verse 6, now when these things were thus ordained, the priest went always into that first tabernacle, accomplishing the service of God. But into the second, that's on the other side of the veil, went the high priest alone, once every year. He better not go in there without no blood. He went in there with some blood. Something had to die for him to get in the presence of God and ask for God's mercy, his love, to be poured out. Something had to die. That's why it says he did not go in there without blood, which he offered for himself and for the errors of the people. The Holy Ghost signifying that the way into the holiest of all was not yet made manifest while the first tabernacle was still standing. So while they were still doing that, the Holy Ghost is saying, there's a better way. There's a better way. But it can't come about as long as this system right here is still in force. This earthly, worldly tabernacle. This is what I'm going to tell you today, is that you got to stop thinking earthly. You got to stop thinking worldly. You got to start thinking heavenly. One of the first things that I come to realize when I got saved in my early days was that it was a prayer that says, as it is in heaven. What was it? So on earth. I said, you mean somebody actually prayed that as it is in heaven, so on earth. And that means that I got heaven right here if I believe that prayer. And then I have to figure out what's in heaven. And when I found out what's in heaven, it kept me saved. Throw something up here if you want. But when I found out there was no poor and no poverty in heaven, I'm in. No sickness, I'm in. It's okay with me. Hallelujah. Peace of mind, no worry, no distress. I'm in. I'm in on that plan. Hallelujah. So many people will argue with you and tell you, and Williams gonna walk and boldly say, no sickness. If sickness hit this body, it's because the sun settled in the, it raised in the west and settled in the east. Something's wrong with creation. And you gotta try to get your faith there. Every man according to his faith, let him have his faith. But when I heard that as it is in heaven, that's good enough for me. Jesus said, as it is in heaven, so let it be on earth. And I took that and ran with it. And when I found out that I don't have to be sick, poor, disgusted, ugly, broke, all those kinds of things, I bought it. Now that's the difference between staying in a rut or rising up with the help of God. Oh, I wish I could get you. Maybe I can show you a little bit more here. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Glory. Hallelujah. Verse 9, which was a figure of the time then present, in which were offered both gifts and sacrifices that could not make him that did the service perfect, as pertaining to the conscience, which stood only in meats and drinks and divers washings and carnal ordinances imposed on them until the time of reformation. But Christ, become a high priest of good things to come, by a greater and more perfect tabernacle, not made with hands, that is to say, not of this building, not of the earth. Christ, high priest, not just a priest, but a high priest. Neither by the blood of goats and calves, but by his own blood, he entered in once into the holy place, having obtained eternal, what, redemption. Hallelujah. Verse 14, how much more shall the blood of Christ, who through the eternal spirit offered himself without spot to God, purge your conscience from what kind of works? To serve the living God. Now, you know, some folks have a problem with living right for God. I would say, well, what is going to be your sacrifice in that day of judgment? What in the heavens are you going to point to if you don't accept that sacrifice right now? Which, how are you going to apply, the word is appropriate faith. See, the reason why I say well and you know, I don't get all that flu shots and all that, is because I know how to appropriate faith. So what are you going to apply your faith to If you fall into a dive of temptations, or if you go to the throne room and you have not accepted Jesus as your Lord and Savior, what are you going to apply? See, I'm taking Jesus' blood and I'm right in front of the mercy seat every day. Lord, look at that blood. Jesus's, without spot, without blemish, on my behalf. Hallelujah. And my conscience agrees with it. What's my conscience? My thinking. It disagrees with it. All I know is that he loved me enough to take his own blood and present it to that mercy seat in the holies of holies. And don't cast away your confidence. Where you're in. Well, yeah, bad stuff does happen. Sometimes it happens to good people. And this is why James said here that, beloved, when you fall into direst kind of situations, count it all joy. Because that's not the permanent state for you. Ooh, hallelujah. Good people, bad, he failed, slipped. Been a mess. He says, count it all joy. Because your apparent setback is a setup. Glory to God. And he goes on with a big if you hold fast to the confession. Hallelujah. If you hold. See, some people have slept, bumped their head, and they curse and everything else. Rascal, dirty dogs. Who left that mop, that wet, everything else is the issue. But he says, if you hold fast to your confession of faith, without wavering, he's faithful. Hallelujah. He'll come through. So let the flat tire happen. Whatever in life. Rejoice at this situation, because it's just a setup to show how God's going to bring is so merciful and wonderful on your behalf. But sometimes I have to, you got to go a little bit further, because people can't buy this mercy seat throne room stuff. They got to hear it straight from, that's too deep. But I'm telling you, Christ is, he's the minister of the sanctuary. He's the minister of heaven. All he wants to do, he's just looking around. Well, I'm just making sure everything's going right. Are they in faith? They believe it? And he said, God's right hand is your high priest. Glory to God. Oh, hallelujah. Chapter 10. We're going to ever get out of Hebrews. For the law having a shadow of good things to come, not the very image of the things, can never with those sacrifices which they offered year by year continually make the comers thereunto perfect. For then would they not have ceased to be offered, because the worshippers, once purged, should not have no more conscience of sin. See, that conscience of sin is just saying, I don't measure up. And it gets in the way of righteousness. So when you have a conscience of sin, you can't be bold like a lion. You can't make your decree and believe it and stand on it. Make your confession, because sin is an issue. And it's the Bible says, if your heart does not condemn you, and that's what sin will do to your heart, it'll condemn you. You have no confidence with God. But if your heart does not condemn you, then you can have confidence with God. Now the word, the Bible says in Hebrews, who's going to come before the throne? The Bible says, let us come boldly to the throne of grace. You got to do it. Let us come boldly to the throne of grace. We can find help, mercy, time of need. Hallelujah. So you got to have confidence in your own prayers. You got to have confidence in your own prayers, in your own heart, and what you believe in your heart. You got to have confidence that when I say it, that's the way I believe. I believe, therefore, that's how I've spoken. Now let's go into chapter 8 of Romans. We're going to conclude over here. Okay, chapter 8, verse 26. Likewise, the Spirit also help our infirmities. For we know not what we should pray for as we ought, but the Spirit itself make intercessions for us, which groanings which cannot be uttered. He that searches the heart know what is the mind of the Spirit, because he maketh intercessions for the saints according to the will of God. Now, so when you go into your prayer closet, your prayer, whatever it is, and you are praying, you got the Holy Ghost helping you. Because he said, the Holy Ghost is there aiding you and says, pray this. Your high priest, he knows what you should be saying, how you should say it. Making intercessions for you, because we are just human, very limited. Verse 28 says, we know that how many things work for my good? All things work together for the good to them who love God, who are called according to what? His purpose. Let that setback show that it's working for my good. Hallelujah. I don't get mad. I don't care what happens. The negative stuff is working for my good. Glory to God. It's working for my good. Hallelujah. So all things. If you know you love God and you know you have a purpose and God, you fulfilling that purpose in God, all things, whatever come up, he turns it around, work it toward your good. Think it not strange when you fall into diverse kinds of mess, different kinds of stuff, situations. Don't think it's so strange, trials, this, try. Don't just do what? Rejoice at the trying of your faith. Glory to God. Oh, hallelujah. When I was a kid on the school ground, I tried to bully. I said, hell, he's big and bad. I'm going to try him. Bad mistake. I don't mess with him no more. Bad mistake. He's what he says he is. Hallelujah. All right. Praise God. Here we go with the word here. Just a little bit. Verse 31. What then should we say to these saints? What then, how can I respond to these things that's happening to me? If God be for us, who can be against us? He spared not his own son, but delivered him up for us all. How shall he not with him also freely give us what? Who shall lay anything to the charge of God's elect? Verse 35, who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Tribulation, distress, persecution, famine, nakedness, peril, or sword, all of this stuff is real. You could be without the proper clothes. You could be persecuted. You could be naked. You could be in distress. It could be many of a number of things that could be going wrong in your life. But the question is, which one is going to separate you from the love of God? Which one is going to cause you to lose faith? That's where a thief comes to steal your faith. He comes to sift you like wheat. Now sing one of Zion's songs. When he trips you up, make you. Now let me hear you sing one of Zion's songs. And the response is on you. It's on us. The response is on us. Hallelujah. Oh, hallelujah. Verse 36, as it is written, for thy sake we'll kill all the day long, counted as sheep for the slaughter. And all these things we are what? More than conquerors. More than conquerors. I am persuaded by the death, life, angels, principalities, powers, things present, nor things to come. No height, nor depth, nor any creature should be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus. Hallelujah. Yeah, it all depends on when the yoga hits the fan, when things don't go so well, whatever. You got to, it all depends. There's only one variable in the whole equation. That's you. Hallelujah. Isaiah said it prophetically, who's going to believe this report? To whom is the arm of the Lord revealed? Hallelujah. Who will believe this report? To whom is the revelation of Jesus Christ revealed. And he goes on to tell you, he should grow up like this. He has no form, no big fashion stuff about him. Hallelujah. But with Israel we know, he was wounded for my transgressions. The chastisement of my peace was upon him, and by his stripes I'm healed. Here's what I know, what he did at the mercy seat. If the blood of bulls, if they put value in that, how much more the blood of Christ? Hallelujah. How much more his blood? Purge my conscience from dead works. Hallelujah. So I can walk in faith. The Bible says the just shall live by what? Faith. Hallelujah. Yeah, it's a faith walk, and anything that is not of faith is sin. It shows that you don't have trust. It's sin. Doubt is sin. Negative talk, vocabulary is sin. It'll keep you set back. But once you start proclaiming, confession, I tell you, you'll see things changing for you, your loved ones, your house. You will see things changing. He that observed the lying vanity gives up on his own deliverance. Hallelujah. But you got to stand there. I don't care what it looks like. I'm the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. Christ did this for me. We're going to finish up here in Romans. I thank God. Hallelujah. One more time, verse 32. He spared not his own son, but delivered him up for us. How should he not with him also freely give us all things? All things. And this depends on where you want to, where you place yourself. I'm on the other side of the veil. I'm not in the law of the earthly tabernacle, doing all these sacrifices, conscious of sin. Do that. Oh, hold up, preacher, before you go on the other side, take my sacrifice and pray for me. No. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Come boldly.
Yes.
Come boldly.
Hallelujah.
To the throne of grace.
Yes.
Father, send now prosperity. Send health now. Bless me now. As Isaiah said, Isaac said to the angel that he was wrestling with before the law came, I ain't leaving till you do what? Bless me. Hundreds of years before the law, I'm walking on promises. You promised me health. You promised me wealth. You promised me peace. You promised me a good life. I'm in the throne room. That's my domain. Hallelujah. But if you're in the throne room and you look back and say, well, I got some insufficiency back there, trouble, anger, sin, I'm in the throne room looking at all the mess. And then as you turn around on the other side of the veil, all the promises. Hallelujah. I go into my Father's house and I get the promises. How about you? Let's all stand together. Hallelujah. 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 Glory. Hallelujah. For me. My glory in the lift of my head. Hallelujah. If I fall, you're my glory. In the lift of my head. Hallelujah. They say he can't come out of that. But thou, O Lord, are what shield for me. My glory and the lifter of my head. I lay me down and I slept. Ooh. Lay down. I awake. The Lord sustained me. Hallelujah. Glory. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. So you got to get it in you. We got to get it in our hearts. Hallelujah. In our hearts. This one says, I'm going to write my laws, my ways in their hearts, in their minds, and then they'll know. It's so available for you. The Logos, the Rhema of God is so available. And there's no excuse to go without, to go through life beat up, beat down. No excuse. Don't have to. Hallelujah. But my advantage, he's the devil's a liar. Jesus says he's a liar. He's been lying since the beginning. Glory to God. Somebody's buying his lies all the time. The devil's a liar. that's what you gotta say. He's alive. I'm healed by his stripes. The joy of the Lord is my strength. What joy I draw water from the wells of salvation. Hallelujah. Father, we thank you today. Woo! Hallelujah. Glory, hallelujah. Hey, Father, there be someone here that heard the preaching of the gospel. Let it sink into that heart, Father. Let it find good ground. Hallelujah. Let it occupy the mind. Glory to God. The thought life. And let it take over the whole body, the whole being. The word of the Lord. It's life to them that find it. And it's healing to all their flesh. Hallelujah. Based on promises. Your precious promises. Delivered through Jesus Christ. We give you all the praise, all of the glory in Jesus' name. Someone give them a praise offering. Hey, we pray for everyone. We can touch and agree on any such thing. Hallelujah. The Lord is my light, my salvation. You got to have it. You got to say it in your mouth. Come with me. Look back. Look like what may be. Appearance. Observation. He that observes those things, forsaking his own mercy. Whose report? Who will believe? Who will believe? That's what Isaiah said. Who will believe this report? To whom is the revelation of the Lord revealed? Hallelujah. God bless you now. To him who is able to keep us from falling, present us faultless before his great throne, the only true, wise God, our Savior, be glory, honor, dominion, and power, both now and forever. Let the church say, amen. God bless you. God bless you.